Blackstone Publishing presents All the Cowboys Ain't Gone, a novel by John J. Jacobson. This book is read by Grover Gardner. To DJJ, DPJ, MPJ, and JKJ, blessings undeserved. SDG. There comes a time in every rightly constructed boy's life when he has a raging desire to go somewhere and dig for hidden treasure. Mark Twain. Part 1. Chapter 1. As the sun climbed into the dazzling South Texas sky, a young boy sat astride his Mustang pony on a low bluff. Looking eastward in the early morning light, he could see a plume of white smoke. The boy wore the chaps and spurs of a drover, though the last major cattle drive in Texas had been in 1885, 3 years ago. His blonde hair, which he wore long in imitation of his father, hung out below his sombrero, as he liked to call his range hat. Slung over his shoulder were a small Comanche-style bow and quiver. His mother wouldn't let him take his .22 caliber rifle out by himself until he turned 12, 3 long months from now. It wasn't unusual for him to ride out early and watch the new day awaken. If asked why he did so, he would say, also imitating his father, "I like getting out and see what's stirring with the new day while it's still fresh and wild, before its newness gets marred by the events of the day." Although riding out early wasn't unusual for him, this wasn't a typical morning for young Lincoln Smith. He had heard the train even before he saw it, and as the dark iron locomotive came into view, pulling its 4 cars and caboose, his temper flared. He didn't know whether to spit or cry. He spurred Rocinante, or Rosie as he called his pony, into a dead gallop toward the train. Directing her with his legs, he knocked an arrow on his bow. When he got within 40 feet of the locomotive, he loosed the arrow at its smokestack, then quickly knocked another arrow and shot the iron beast again, reloaded, and shot once more. The engineer and the fireman in the locomotive didn't know what to think at the first arrow. Then they started yelling and cursing at him. Lincoln would have chased the train farther and shot more arrows, but he had made his point. Besides, if he didn't get back home by 8 o'clock, he would have another kind of problem to deal with. His mother started his school lessons then, and she didn't tolerate tardiness. Mrs. Rachel Smith, Lincoln Smith's mother, was just getting up. Leaving her bedroom, she found the fire already burning in the fireplace and the front door slightly ajar. She walked over to the window and looked outside. On the porch steps, she saw her son sitting with his head in his hands, mumbling something. It wasn't all that unusual to see him talking to himself, but sometimes his passionate imagination did cause her some concern. All of a sudden, he sprang up. Grabbing his bow and quiver, he ran off toward the side of the barn. Rachel leaned over, trying to see what he had run after, but he disappeared around the back of the barn. Then she heard a canine yelp. "What have you been doing out there?" she asked him a few minutes later when he walked into the house. "A coyote was sneaking around the barn. It's the one that's been trying to get at the chickens. I hit him in the flank and my arrow stuck. But my bow's too darn small, and I didn't bring him down. I need a real bow, or else you ought to let me take my rifle out." "What did I tell you about using that word?" his mother scolded, bothered more by his language than by some chicken-filching coyote. "Darn isn't really cussing," the boy said as respectfully as he could, while still making what he considered a valid point. "It's close enough," his mother said. "If you can't think of a better word, you'd best say nothing at all. Speech like that is a sign of a poor vocabulary. And take off your spurs when you're in my house. I don't want you scuffing the floor or the furniture." "Yes, ma'am," Lincoln said, frowning slightly. He sat down on the chair by the front door and removed his spurs, a gift from one of his father's old Texas Ranger friends. The spurs were among his most prized possessions. They were compact and light and had silver conchos on the metal heel band, and the polished steel rowels had 7 points. But what Lincoln liked best about them was their age and the experiences they had behind them. "And don't forget to remove your hat while you're at it," his mother said as he was hanging the spurs next to the boot jack by the door. Lincoln walked over to the table where they would shortly be starting his lessons. He took off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.